Okay.
Hello everybody and welcome to round two of the SRO Kart Factor 98. So we're here at Daytona Road Course and with me in the commentary shorts today is George. So what are your opinions on this track, George?
George isn't in the commentary box. George is racing.
That's gone off. Well, Richard, sorry.
Well, it should be an interesting race. Got a couple of different strategies going. People not really sure what tyre is going to work for the race and not really sure what aero is going to work out. So there's going to be a lot of slipstreaming, a lot of strategy playing out with the tyres, and we'll just have to see how it goes.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is an hour-long race, so but obviously, you know, you don't want to wreck early on. The priority for these drivers is making it to the end of the race. And as long as they do that, then you never know. I mean, you've got to be in it to win it, so you don't want to go risking it all in the early laps.
Indeed. Especially in this mod, the early laps will bite you when the tyres are cold. It's can be a little bit tricky to get the tyres up to temperature, but I think the cars will remain a challenge all the way through the race.
Yep, so we're on a 5-minute warm-up session now then, just before the race for the drivers to make any last-minute adjustments to the car. I mean, obviously, you know, the adrenaline may start to pump in now. So obviously, Richard, you know, you're used to these sort of circumstances. How would you treat this warm-up session?
I don't know. Well, usually, just go through any last-minute checks, check on my strategy, make sure all the settings are ready to go. If I've adjusted qualifying setup, switch it back or vice versa. Let's do maybe a couple of laps, practice pit stops, and then we'll get ready to go for the race. Try and keep calm and not get overexcited.
Been a lot of talk before the race amongst the drivers about the aerodynamic package, which one to run here. And some have actually been considering running an oval wing setting to get an advantage on the straights, since that seems to be the way it gets speed around.
I mean, the thing is as well, with a track like this, when it's half oval, half track, it really does come down to setup at the end of the day. And if you just go a millimetre out on one of the wings, then that can cost you a good tenth of a second.
Yes, sir.
Indeed, I did notice actually through warm-up that our second place car, Samuel Leoninen, was running cambers, which looked pretty much perfect for running on the oval, but he looked to get in a bit of a tricky situation around the rest of the track. Just to give you a rundown of the top five cars, we've got Andreas Eriksson on pole position with a 128.1, followed by Leoninen in second with a 128.2, Peter Enders in third, 28.2, Anders Nilsson in fourth with a 128.3, and Mohammed Patel rounding out the top five on a 128.4. So across the top five cars, we've got about a gap of 0.4. So it's going to be tight at the front of the grid.
Yeah, I mean, especially, you know, we've seen how close racing can get around the ovals. It's pretty much bumper to bumper. So if they can sort of maintain these speeds around, then we could see some fantastic racing today.
Yeah, here's hoping high speed passing. It's going to be a lot of... I think there's going to be a lot of difficulties out there for some drivers. When do they make the pass? When do they avoid the passes? And how do they deal with the faster cars when they get in the draft? One little mistake coming out of the hairpin and losing 10 miles an hour on your exit. It's going to be pretty critical as you come down through the bus stop and then round into the tri-oval here at Daytona.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, this track has earned its reputation for a very good reason. It really can either make people's races or break them in just a split second, and so it'll be very interesting to see just how the drivers treat it, who goes aggressive early on or who tries to conserve a bit and then, you know, just go all out later on. And of course, pit stops are a big strategy as well, so who stops early and who stops late, again, it's all going to play a part.
Yeah. But the tyres will only last about 20 laps around here. Soft or hard seems to make not much of a difference. And so we're going to see quite a few stops of tyres.
Yeah, so we have just 40 seconds to go now then before the race gets underway. Of course, it's a rolling start, so the tension does seem to build then for the drivers, as you see a car almost missing the pit box slightly there. So again, just with these last few seconds, drivers will try and desperately pit in, just try and make sure they have those pit stops right, because if you do just miss your pit box by like an inch, it can actually cost you a lot of time And if you're fighting for a high position such as a podium, that's not really, really the way you want to go about it.
Yeah, especially when the top five times are so very close to each other, you miss your pit box and pull up a bit earlier, pull up a bit late, and cost yourself a couple of seconds, you might not ever get it back on the track. Possibly another factor in this race is we've got some drivers towards the back of the pack that are not quite as quickly, sorry, not as quite as quick in their lap times, so it'll be interesting to see what happens when we get into traffic, see how the drivers cope with that. Should just be heading into the race very shortly. Drivers have just had their final race briefing, so and here we go into the race now.
Yep, so you're taking a look at number 21, and if that number is just as lucky as he was for Trevor Bayne when he raced at Daytona, could we see him win the race maybe? Or, you know, we're looking at Ericsson, of course, so the pole sitter will be looking to get off to a fantastic start. So here is then your top eight. You see Mohammed Patel rounds out the top five, and just below him, you know, it is extremely close, and there's quite a lot of drivers in there as well. So these drivers are going to have to watch themselves, especially for the first corner when they get in towards the inner circuit. They have to try and maintain their composure and not go dive bombing for anything.
Here we are on board with our pole sitter. Gets the field off to start. It's a manual formation start, so it's no safety car. So Ericsson will be controlling the field himself. Bring the field round, and I believe they're going out of the bus stop.
Yeah, I mean, and how vital is pole position as well? To lead the field away on a manual start can give you such a big advantage, as you can just literally dive as soon as you see the straight, just go for it, and it easily pull out around half a second if you play the cards right.
Should be an interesting start.
Definitely an advantage to be here, to be in control of the field.
So as they go round the inner circuit then, so not only can Daytona produce some of the most fantastic oval races, it can also produce, you know, some of the best short track races as well. I mean, this circuit has everything a driver wants, you know. It's got the long right hands that you need, it's got the short snappy corners to try and get the overtaking moves down, and then of course onto the oval where you can be side by side and bumper to bumper for essentially the whole run.
Yeah, there's a couple of tricky corners around this circuit that seem to be a little bit quicker on the entry than you'd expect them to be, and a couple of corners on this particular version that we were running this evening where the grip just doesn't seem to be anywhere but on the racing line, and it really tapers off dramatically actually as you go towards the outside of the circuit. So any driver that's going to be able to make the move is going to have to pick his point really carefully just to avoid running into a part of the circuit where the grip's just going to drop off.
So here we go then, Ericsson brings the field round on towards the back stretch. So one more corner for the field to try and all bunch up so they can get as close as they can to him, but also a last opportunity to try and warm the tyres up, because you don't really want to go into the first lap with cold tyres. So round they come then in towards turn three, and you know, the nerves will be getting a bit higher now between some of the drivers. It's all about maintaining your composure, as we've said before. And, you know, especially in the first lap, you don't want any incidents to occur. But, you know, this is racing. You can see that second place getting as close as he can up towards Ericsson. He does not want to lose some time off the start. So here comes Ericsson then, on towards the final corner. The third place desperately ducking and diving, trying to get as much heat into the tyres as possible. And we are about to go green flag at Daytona.
Or are we?
We're stopping for a standing start, it looks like,
then. I would hazard guess that, once again, the server has not been set up correctly, so I believe they will go around for a second formation lap.
So what would that do mentally, then, to your pole sitter Ericsson? I mean, because sure, you'll be a bit frustrated about that, but... Yeah. Oh, no, so we are on a standing start, then, so it's four lights. And we're away, are we probably racing now? Yeah, 59 minutes left on the clock, and we're away then. At Daytona, you can see that straight away, second place having a look around the outside.
Nope, we're going for another formation lap, looks like.
So the formation lap probably will count towards the time at the end, I'm guessing.
Yeah, then. So we're going to lose maybe 2.5 minutes off the race start.
But, and that could be absolutely critical as well. Of course, you know, 2.5 minutes is plenty of time that these drivers would quite happily have at the end if they're fighting for position.
Well, it'll be interesting now because they've burnt off, well, they'll be burning off 2 laps worth of fuel on the formation lap. Obviously they'll have the boost turned down in the car, so they'll be trying to use it as little as possible. But for those drivers that light fueled the car, they maybe have a little bit have to pit in lap earlier, or maybe two laps earlier than they were intending to do. And those drivers that took in a little bit of extra fuel in it, maybe they were hoping to eke out tyres, might just be able to sneak in front of a couple of drivers when we come round to the pit stops. Shouldn't be too much of a issue with the fuel, but it may turn out to play a role. We'll see.
Perhaps I'll just go for an answer. Leonin, it will be, of course, just behind Ericsson. So, I mean, it really is very close between the top five, as we've said. So, on towards the backstretch once again, then, comes Ericsson.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the intention was to have them start out of the bus stop, but we'll see what happens this time round.
If you go for another formation, that's not really going to go down well with any of the drivers, and none more so than the pole sitter.
I've just double-checked the race briefing, so they are going to be going at the start-finish line, so Ericsson's going to bring them onto the trial. They'll go side by side, and then they will begin the race as they come into this cross the start-finish line. So it's going to be a really short run into that first turn, and the field going to be quite tightly bunched as they head in there, so I'd expect to see maybe some incidents as we go into that first turn. It's got quite a tightening up apex, so it'll be interesting to see who causes the incident or manages to avoid the incident.
A generous runoff area, and then one will definitely be used here at the start.
Yeah, for sure, but this runoff area on this particular version of the circuit's actually not tarmac. It's gravel, so I think anyone that does run wide might find themselves quickly ripping off a wheel. But we're coming onto the tri-oval now.
You can almost feel the tension in the atmosphere. You could cut it with a knife. All the drivers fully focused on one thing, and that is winning the second round of the R-Factor Karts 98 mod. So here we go then. Around then, onto the driver, as we've said. Ericsson's going to need a good start, and they go. Flying then, and
starting
now, I believe so, here we go.
Go on,
excellent,
very good
job. Cutting any move for Leon and in towards turn one. Let's just see if the whole pack can bunch through and without any incidents. Looking quite good at the moment.
A little contact in the back of the pack there.
And a bit of a lock up there by Enders, so he gets very, very up close and personal to Leon.
Front of the field seems to have got away smoothly. Spacing out from each other quite nicely.
So the gap then between second and third is 0.166, and again not very much, so but the rest of the field seems to be okay. There was some contact in the background, not too sure who that was between, but there was no major damage done, I don't think. So on towards the second lap.
Looks like we've got some action between Matt Strand and Mark Foley. There are in sixth and seventh place, I believe. Here we are with Matt Strand at the moment.
Well, round the outside then goes Strand, and he's going to push right to the wall. I mean,
Mark Foley down the inside.
Then, as they will come onto the tri-oval, and it'll be very interesting to see who comes out on top of this. Nilsson's in there as well.
It's a beautiful pass there by Mark Foley. Comes from 7th place there, manages to take 5th. Matt Strand got blocked by Nilsson. Nilsson not slighting Mark Foley. Mark Foley sneaks up the inside and takes both places.
Yeah, but now Strand is not going to take any of that lightly. He's looking right back. Just looking at the inside of Nilsson there. He's actually gone round the outside. He couldn't be three wide again there. Nilsson's stuck in the middle in a very tricky place. But a bit of contact looks like. But the car's gone out as a yellow card out. I think that may have been Mohamed Patel, if I'm not mistaken.
Mohamed Patel is in the fourth already. He's off the road.
So he's off to a flying start then. Of course, the Englishman who's quite an accomplished FSR driver into the World Championship has moved his way out the field into fourth. Could he fight for a podium? Still side by side. And another position lost there for Strand.
Well, they went back to their original position from the beginning of the previous lap into the first turn there. And Strand was alongside Nilsson, and Nilsson just ran him out of road quite fairly so. Strand's dropped back a bit and back into the clutches of Mark Foley. So it'll be interesting to see what happens this time as we come back onto the banking here at Daytona.
Foley's want to get on the throttle as soon as he can to try and pick up the draft from the back of Matt Strand's car. And everybody just thinks to get a bit of leeway just to boost off the end of the straight in towards turn one, and some side-by-side action there again. Because there's still Nilsson and Dryan going at it. And
Dryan takes the position. Like Nilsson's dropped back a little bit, perhaps into the clutches of Mark Foley here as they come into the tri-oval.
Still after lap one, it's Ericsson your leader. He's quite a healthy 0.7 second gap at the moment. So I think he'll be looking to retain that, if not make it a hell of a lot bigger as the race will go on. And then George Power, they're down in 10th at the moment, so he's trying to pull his way up the field.
Yeah, he's got his work cut out.
Oh, he's got a spin. Huge spin now. I think, Timo Toika in the flying arms car down to P12 now. I don't think there was any contact with the wall, but nonetheless, that's a deafening blow to his chances of a race win. Of course, you know, we're still not at 10 minutes past, but that's not the way you want to start off a race.
Certainly, it looks he just snatched his rear brakes there. He went in a little bit too hot. Just rotated the car around. He was lucky not to collect anyone or collect the wall. He's off back up running again, so it shouldn't be too long before he gets involved there. And there's someone else there off at the side again.
It's Matt Strand, actually. If we go back, there may have been Strand. I think it was Strand then, because now Foley has got a
Mark
knife
Foley, yeah.
On the inside of Nilsson. So it must have been contact then between Nilsson and Strand yet again. But Foley fancies his chances. He can't quite get it, though, as they enter bus stop.
No, that wasn't Matt Strand that was off at the side, because Matt Strand is all over the back of Mohamed Patel. Get you that. Here's Mohamed Patel taking four.
Hey, Patel's going to have to go defensive round the inside. That bright blue car has got a very dark blue colour. Strand trying to get all over the back of him, round the outside. That's not going to work. He's going to have to sweep it round, and he's going to run out of road before soon, and very well defended by Patel. Still though, Strand pushing around the outside. Still almost pushing the very edge of the circuit, and I think Strand had got the inside line. And he's not going to make contact, but still, or he could lose out to Nilsson and Foley here. So, very, very competitive racing here already, just in the opening stages, and we have seen a few incidents, but I think the drivers need to calm down a bit and get into a rhythm.
Go on board with Mark Foley here as he chases down Mohamed Patel.
So we need to try and get off some very nice run there. Patel goes a bit weakly and really inside there. Very good move by Foley, and that has given him the position.
Yeah, it looks like Mohamed's got on the gas a little bit too hard and then pulled into second gear, and it just spun up the rear tyres long enough for Mark to get the run up. Oh, Mohamed slams the door across the front of Mark Foley and holds onto the position going into the tri-oval.
It's all very competitive, and of course, I mean, you say about trying to keep your composure and stay calm, but when you're racing for third positions, you obviously want to try and make as much ground as you can in the opening stages, so you can kind of take your mind off things during the latter stages of the race and just ease off and make sure you get to the end. But Patel is having none of that. They're going straight on the back of Foley then, around the outside. He's going to be ducking and diving, and he's gone straight around the outside. Bit of a lock up there, and then the contact there. Foley manages to make a big save, but Nilsson is going to try and cut across, and he's off! Foley is way off course. I think Nilsson may have cut him slightly, but Foley is going way, way down the field, and that is disastrous for Foley.
He's back up and running. Just looks like Mohamed cut him a bit hard, and then as Foley tried to get back on the power again, car snatched at him and spun him out. But he'll get back up and running, and we'll see how it pans out for him.
So we're 10 minutes into this hour-long race, and Ericsson is still your leader. And he's still close, followed by Leonen. The exact gap is 1.3 seconds, so no one here for Rainbow, but right now Ericsson's in a kind of league of his own, just keeping at it, just fully focused. He's got to drive lap after lap cleanly, but Leonen is gaining, though, and he's right now trying to hold off Enders. And that could be affecting Leonen's pace, as he's more focused on defending as opposed to catching the back of Ericsson.
Here we are aboard with Enders, looking to take away that second position, looks to the outside.
Might be pushed to the wall, very nearly cut off there. Just defended by Leonen, but that was a bit too aggressive for my liking, I think. still, and it's looking all over the back of it, guys, to the inside, and it's all time in a contact there. There's still time inside, I think. Enders managed to adjust his weight through as a kind of bit of karma, just swinging his way back round for Ericsson, because that was a very, for Lienemann, beg your pardon, because that was a very aggressive defending manoeuvre.
Well, all fair and love and war.
This will be interesting to see how much can Enders pull back onto your wave seed at Ericsson. Matt Strand up to fourth. How can he catch these two? If these two are jostling, this could work out very, very well for Strand, as he could find his way battling for a podium position.
Yeah, he's got strong pace, much stronger pace than he showed in qualifying. Seems to definitely be catching on to the front pack. Looks like everything's gone a little bit quiet on track. We might have a little battle here between Nathan Robinson and number 15th place of the 16 car.
So driver signs are settling down now, and well, we are very fast approaching the first round of pit stops, so we're expecting maybe in around 10-15 minutes time.
Yeah, this looks like the closest path on the track at the moment. Simon Wattman and Nathan Robinson as they come down towards the bus stop.
Robertson has had a few incidents in the warm-up and qualifying. So, be interesting to see what he can do defending-wise. Just keep his head straight. 0.4, the gap between Robinson and Wattman at the moment, though, for a top 15 position. Of course, I think it's the top 12 which score points, so every points position now will be contested for, but you have to try and get there first, and Watson will not want to try and hold back if he tries to get past Robinson.
Yeah, well, Robinson definitely seems to get a massive drive out of the bus stop there. He's pulled out a sizable gap there. Definitely got Simon out of the draft, so for now it looks like he might be okay. I think Robinson had a bit of a sloppy first sector on the previous lap, so I'm not entirely sure that what's happening at the moment is indicative of his pace, but we'll see how that develops.
Yeah, so he's sort of dropped back in now, Watson, so he's going to just try and... Oh, he's got one!
No, Robinson's off! Robinson's off!
Yeah, so I think he's just outbraked himself there, and by the time he's tried to correct it, he's already gone off the track, so that's given Watson a position and maybe a bit of a weight off his shoulders. Robinson's still in 16th at the moment now, so I don't think he's lost too many positions.
Looks like we have another possible pass for position. It's Mark Foley back in the wars again. Smolcheski making the pass there as we go and go to them now. Smolcheski takes the position on the inside.
Down to 10th turn for Matt Foley. He's been struggling all race, really. It's been, about 14 minutes in, and he just hasn't really been able to try and keep up there with the main runners. He's trying to prove us wrong now as he goes up the inside. It's almost wheel to wheel as they enter the end of the back stretch. And it's going to be a straight drag race in towards turn one as they go through the tri-oval. And you've got to be wary, though. Of course, you've got a nice little sneaky car behind him. He's going to go through the middle there. And they're going to be three wide. That's surely going to be carnage. No. But there is carnage. And there goes Timo Toika. I think he's managed to save that one. But he's getting out of very, very little lead there by Toika to try and get himself involved with that one.
Indeed, very lucky for Smolcheski there. I would have, I would have suspected he might have some rear suspension damage there, or at very least rear wing damage, because he had a bit of a sizable hit there from Timo behind. And Timo, costly for him, he's dropped back to 12th position behind Nick Phillips, who's picked up a spot for 05 Motorsport.
Yeah, so he's pretty brave move there, pretty heroic move that it paid off, but it just wasn't worth the risk in the end then for Toika. Well, it's still 45 minutes to go, it's not all over until the checkered flag falls, and right now we've got a hell of a long way to go. So it's all about just getting those key positions and then finding the rhythm and just holding it for as long as you can. That's what Foley needs to do, and just try and keep away from Smolcheski, I beg your pardon.
So our second 05 Motorsports driver, George Talbot, is making up his move on 2 seconds Shella Steinbach for 8th position. Let's try and get on board with him now. Here we are on board with George Talbot, the second of the 05 Motorsports drivers, going into the first turn. This has been a development battle. George has been slowly catch on the back of Stenbeck, and we'll see what he can make of it.
A bit of a look at there from Stenbeck as well, and as long as the Talbot can just keep the pressure on, then Stenbeck keeps making mistakes. I mean, you could see a pretty simple move, but it's all about pressure, and he's saving and just trying to make sure that... Oh, and a bit of lock up again there by Stenbeck. So right now Talbot is just going to make sure if there is a huge mistake by Stenbeck, he keeps well clear of it. Maybe make a move then as they go onto the able section off the Daytona circuit. He's maybe going to have a look at the final corner, not quite close enough. But as they go onto the able, let's hide on board then with Talbot and see. Maybe he can make something stick. He's getting quite a nice draft, but he's a bit far back at the moment.
Yeah, Stenbeck was one of the drivers during practice who was toying with the idea of running a different chassis setup. In this mod, there's a number of chassis setups available. Majority, as far as I'm aware, the majority of drivers are running the road course option, but of course there is the option to run the short track oval or the speed oval or whatever wing settings you like. The only viable option of those is the road course, but the short oval one might give you a top speed advantage, although you'd be slower in the first and second sectors. So it'll be interesting to see how this pans out. Stenbeck definitely seems to have the top speed, because even in the draft there, George is unable to make anything of it.
Well, I think through the short now though, George is looking pretty strong as he almost had to outbreak himself there and be wary, because he's going straight to the back of Stenbeck, but he's getting scarily close to the back of that bright yellow park back the car. So here we go then, a big, again, knock up by Stenbeck. I think, well, Stenbeck's done, he's focused all the setup on that top speed. I may be wrong, but he's looking very quick to the vehicle, but as soon as he hits through the inner track, he just can't quite find the drift into the corners and he's looking great. And that, of course, isn't going to, aid the tyre wear at all, and he could be forced to make an early stop as Talbot is all over the back of him right now.
The question is, Stenbeck is turning up his boost to try and defend his position.
Yeah,
which
that
might
could be a
turn
problem.
Out disastrous for him later in the race, since he's been kind of notorious for blowing up if you run them too aggressively.
See, now this is where it's going to be interesting, because Stenbeck does seem to have the advantage on the able, so if Talbot's going to be taking all this information in, then he's going to have to kind of realise that if he wants to make a move, it has to be on the actual inner track section.
Just to update you on the trials and tribulations of Mark Foley, he looked like he'd gapped Mark Smolcheski for a while, and made a mistake coming onto the oval and looped the car around, so there was actually contact with him and Toyka. So they've spun around and it's dropped Mark further back in the pack.
Very nice run. He's trying to go back on the outside. Very well defended by Stenbeck as they go in towards turn one again. Locked up there by Stenbeck. Talbot is all over the back again, but he can't quite make it stick. Sorry for interrupting you there.
No worries. I was just trying to find something to talk about while we were waiting for George to finally get this done. It's looking like the toughest battle on track at the moment.
It really is. I mean, Stenbeck's doing a good job of holding his composure, but he has to try and either alleviate his foot off the throttle a bit earlier and just slowly on the brakes, because now he's gone a bit wide and Talbot could find his way through again, getting very up close and personal to the back of the rear wing. But, you know, it has to be said, Stenbeck will have the advantage on the able, and Talbot knows that, so he has to try and make everything stick if he wants a position, because right now he isn't doing his, you know, points bids any good as he tries to move up in the championship standings.
Yeah, George needs to have a good race here.
Yeah, and the brutal reality of George's situation is that even if he makes a pass down the down in the road section, Stenbeck has a huge advantage to go on the speed, and then accounting for the draft, he might just shoot right back past him.
If Talbot can make a move, you know, on towards one of the final corners as they head onto the back of the oval, then there is going to be a speed advantage for Stenbeck. So I mean, Talbot has to be working all this out in his mind and pinpointing a move, where he's going to go, how Stenbeck's going to react in his head, and that's just a natural thing of the driver. But back up front, Ericsson is still your leader from Enders now, as Leonen was, of course, dropped to third. But the gap between first and third is 5 seconds now, so there's a huge lead for Ericsson at the moment, as he's starting to pull away quite nicely.
Yeah, indeed, and it looks at some point, unfortunately we've missed this, that Matt Strand has fallen back behind. Oh, he's just repassed him. He was just behind Mohamed Patel, but he's retaking the position.
He's doing bad fireworks early on in the race, and we hate to see it repeat. But right now, Patel is looking very, very feisty just behind the back of Strand.
Oh, Oh, Strand's run a little bit wide. This is going to give Patel the chance.
Chances then up the inside as they enter the back stretch of the oval. And that's going to be very close then as they will come on towards the triangle. But Patel looking like he may just sneak this one, but he's able to cut across too early. We've just seen that before with Timo Toivonen, and we don't want to see a repeat of that. But right now, Patel's looking like he's got the position. Got to have to defend those. Strand's going to surely go around the outside, and he does. But it's going to be very close. But Patel through onto resuming the oval. I think he cut the corner a little bit there. But
yeah, Mohammed's got a rather strong history of cutting that corner, but doesn't actually have to look to have given him any advantage here, as once again Matt Strand is all over the back of him, looking to pick up that toe and make his move into the first turn.
Yep, Strand's having another trolley. He's trying to duck out of that slipstream now, but Patel is defending very well. It has to be said, if not a bit too aggressive though, and Strand's going to know that, so if we cut back to the battle between Talbot and see how that's developing, and then... Oh, what's happened there then? Because Sundex actually caught out quite a gap, so Talbot may have made a mistake at some point during the last couple of laps. Stenbeck is looking to run okay, so don't think we're in contact between the two. Although Stenbeck is still locking up the brakes, and I'm sure he's going to have to be thinking of making a pit stop quite soon, because those tyres are going to be very, very hard to handle. I mean, it's all going to be, especially as you head towards the pit stop, just who can handle their tyres the best. And again, Stenbeck goes to a very wide line through that corner, whether that's intended or no, is another matter. But it can't be on me too bad at the moment, a 1.6 second gap between Talbot. So, if you can maintain that, it should be okay.
Indeed, our leader Ericsson has completed 13 laps. The rumours before the start of the race was that the tyres would be going about 20 laps or so. So we've got about 6 laps to go until we see the first of the pit stops. But we might see some drivers just run a bit of strategy. Some guys may decide to pit to try and break up any battles that they're in, try and get some clear air and run away from the field if they can.
To get off strategy on Stenbeck here, see if he can put in a few fast laps. Maybe he's saved a little fuel in the draft all the way around his past few laps.
This will be interesting then, as we see Patel and Strand go across the line. Patel still holds third position at the moment, but look who sort of crept up into this battle, and that's Nilsson. So these three, of course, have had plenty of opportunity to learn each other's driving styles out in a major battle earlier on. And you might just see Andreas Nilsson just stepping up towards the background and ready to capitalise on a mistake. So, of course, these Strand and Patel, very, very aggressive drivers, and I think will stop at nothing to get a position. So, I think if Andreas Nilsson plays his cards right, he should find himself very much in front of the podium position.
Indeed, it looks like we have had our first pit stops. Nathan Robinson and Timo Toivonen have both pitted. Although I think at some points Leoninen must have made a mistake, because he's dropped back into 6th place, which has put Mohammed Patel up into 3rd. So the battle between Patel, Matt Strand and Nilsson is now for 3rd position. Up at the front of the field, Peter Enders is only 4 tenths off the back of Ericsson.
So Enders is going very well at the moment, and I think he's going to have to try and use that mentality advantage over Ericsson, because Ericsson is going to see those times, and depending on whether he panics or no, those times are going to increase or decrease, because the last thing you're going to do as a driver, see a car, you know, slowly closing on you and start to panic, and then you start to let that get on top of you and you won't take the corners as well as you should do. So if both these guys can keep their heads, then we should see a very entertaining battle. But the battle for 3rd, 4th and 5th is still raging on, and Patel currently leads, and that's Strand diving into the pits, is that? Matt Strand going on, yeah, Matt Strand's on pit road then. So the first of these three, so is he trying to get a little leapfrog, perhaps, as Leonin moves his way up towards Nilsson.
It's like they're recovering Leonin, actually, and it looks like he's...
Oh, he's gone again! Oh, Leonin in the wall, and I don't think that's going to end his race, but that's going to be a major dent in his bid for a podium position. And starting way out the field, it's slowly going from bad to worse, and he's not going to be a very happy bunny in that car right now.
Especially like not considering the winner of the first round, so he's definitely not inexperienced in driving these cars.
Definitely not, and it looked like it's from little look up the up between the two cars into turn one. He had a shunt with one of the others, and looks like it's damaged his car because he's been very slow since then. Had a lot of spins.
Leonin's going to be on pit road, but it's going to be the strategy. Oh, he's spun again! Leonin onto, almost a drift there, but he's heading towards a barrier, and I think he may have just collected that. Yeah, in the wall then is your previous race winner, And he's out of the race.
And he's out of the race.
And is Leonin. And what a major blow to his championship hopes is that.
Well, it looks like that first contact probably damaged his rear suspension there. And as he's tried to get back onto the oval, he's just lost it and put it in the wall and decided that that's enough and he's going to park the car for the rest of the day. Just to give you an update. Sorry. Andreas Nilsson, Ericsson, leads Peter Enders second and Mohamed Patel now in third. And it looks like Matt Strand is dropped into seventh place behind George Talbot after his pit stop.
Thing is, I think what Matt Strand has done, the strategy is going to be very, very, you know, on the edge. If it's either going to work or it's not. If it doesn't work, he's going to find himself down the order. But because he stopped early, he's going to try and use those new tyres to get the time back, get as close to it as possible and perhaps leapfrog them. But then, of course, the only downside is that as soon as he, if he can't overtake them, then you've got two very aggressive drivers on fresh sets of tyres who are going to be extremely quick. So it's a very risky idea here by Sam, but it could pay off. It's the run board with number 7, with Peter Enders.
So this is Peter Enders, wait for the... Looking at a pass for position there for the lead of the race, he definitely seems to have got a better run out. He's compromised his exit out of the bus stop and Ericsson's pulling out the road. I'd expect these guys to be pitting within about 4 laps time. And it'll be interesting to see how this one pans out.
Yeah, pit strategy of course is going to be key right now because, you know, just think, if a split second can separate these two guys. So Ericsson is putting a lot of pressure. Well, we're trying to have to illuminate a lot of pressure because Enders, if he can pit in just before and then come out and leapfrog, he's going to be quite good. I think that's the best idea because if you get on the pressure tyres before, get the leapfrog done in the pits and then try and defend, because right now I can't see a pass happening within the next couple of laps personally.
Indeed. We've got another couple of drivers just pitted. Mike Molcheski has completed his pit stop for the race, as has John Clark. And an update on our unfortunate DNFs. Timo Toika, DNF, just a lap before our P2 driver, Leonin.
I'm actually going to try and Timo in for interview and see what he has to say.
Definitely, unfortunately, at this point, the actions diluted a little bit as drivers begin their pit strategy, so the only really close action we have on the field at the moment is Fenders, who's still just holding on to Ericsson, unable to shake him. Whether or not that's a choice by Ericsson just to conserve strategy a little bit, maybe run a lower boost just to manage the gap rather than pull the gap away, not sure, but I would have put money on Ericsson having he'd prefer to have a substantially larger gap here, as Peter Enders goes very deep on the brakes and gets really close to the back of Ericsson into the first turn.
And Ericsson isn't going to like that view, and Enders streaming behind him, desperately trying to find a move. And I think he's going to lose a lot of grip going into the corner though, as Enders all over the back of the first quick lead to Ericsson, and Ericsson's going to do everything he can to defend it right now. And he goes up the outside then, no, inside of the so side by side, and what have given up. So with us now then is Timo Toika. So Timo, what just went wrong in that race?
Well, I just didn't feel comfortable with the track and car combo and didn't practice enough.
So what are your opinions on the next track then? Do you still see yourself, you know, within the title fight or?
Nah, I can't see myself in the title fight. But I've always liked Road America.
Okay, well, we'll look forward to seeing you there. So, just before you go, have you picked the winner for today, or...?
Is Andreas Eriksson still in?
He has just lost first position, as Peter Enders has managed to take that away from him.
Oh, that's sad. Yeah, Eriksson was my man for the win.
Okay, well, thanks for your time, Timo, and again, sorry for the retirement, but we'll look forward to seeing you very soon for round 3 and hope you have the rest of a good week.
Yeah, thanks. And you too.
So back to the action here then, and already Enders has got a 1.074 second gap over Ericsson. and it's looking quite sweet now. I think Anders has made the right decision in not fitting in, and which is the opposite of what I recommended, so that's why I shouldn't be a race engineer.
Well, they've definitely crossed the threshold now, so this will be a one-stop race for Anders and Ericsson. They've definitely proved that they can make the tires last. Don't think that'll be the case with Stenbeck with all the locking up, though.
I think Nilsson and Patel may have pitted in because, well, Nilsson's 18 seconds.
Nilsson's still running. Patel has pitted, he's just completing his pit stop, leaving the pit lane now as George Talbot is pulling away from his pit box, and it looks like Stenbeck is actually out of the race. He is indeed.
After fighting with Talbot, there could have been a bit of minor contact, perhaps.
Well, we have just reached the halfway point, or just passed it rather, of the race. So I'll give you a rundown of the top running cars. Peter Enders now leads the race. He has managed to pull out a rather substantial gap of around 2 seconds to Andreas Eriksson. Anders Nilsson in third place, followed by Mohamed Patel, Matt Strand, George Talbot, Nick Phillips, Mark Foley, Sergio Sousa and John Clark. Nathan Robinson, Simon Wattman and Mike Smolcheski round out the remaining drivers. We have 13 drivers left in the race. Smolcheski has dropped to last position now, having had to complete 2 pit stops. Only the top 3 now remain who haven't pitted. And now all the cars have pitted. Peter Enders, Andreas Eriksson and Anders Nilsson have all now completed their pit stops as Matt Strand enters the tri-oval. Not sure he's going to have enough time to take this position away from Andreas Nilsson. Oh, he is, in fact. As will Mohamed Patel.
So things are definitely heating up then. As we said, we've crossed the halfway mark now, so half left, half to go. And if the second half is as interesting as the first half, then we're going to see a very exciting closure to this race.
Indeed, it looks like, courtesy of the way that's played out, that Anders Nilsson, Mohamed Patel and Matt Strand are the closest cars together on the field. We'll just have a look at them now. Here we are with Matt Strand, whose early pit stops paid dividends. He's managed to get himself out of the traffic that he was running in, pulled a little bit of a gap, and let's see how he deals with this as we towards the end of this race. Mohamed Patel in fifth place. Anders Nilsson rounding out the top 5.
So it's looking pretty good now. So Nilsson is 21 seconds away then. Strand down 4th, Patel 5th. If these three end up in battle again, well, we could see some major fireworks. And Patel's already just, 2 points seconds away from Andreas Nilsson as he tries to put the pressure on, pedal to the metal around Daytona to try and lead up another position.
Indeed, Patel's been looking very, very racy this evening. His speciality is in the open wheel car, so it really is everything to play for him. Having a look at their best lap times, it looks like Patel has a lap time advantage over Matt Strand, as does Nilsson, so it'll be interesting to see if Matt Strand begins to hold up this pair as they try to fight over that third position.
Will the gap start to form then? So the closest battle on track will be when it forms Nilsson and Patel. And of course, things with these two as well, you see both know each other very well from Formula Sim Racing. They'll know each other's driving styles after going through a whole season together, so it's very interesting to see just who comes out on top between these two gladiators.
Indeed, and back with George Talbot, who was in the wars earlier with Stenbeck. He's now running in sixth place. He's 20 seconds off the top 5 running. But he's looking to recover some points. He had hoped to put in a better effort 2 weeks ago at Long Beach. However, he encountered some difficulties in that race and ended up without a finish. His 05 Motorsports teammate, Nick Phillips, is now running in 7th place. So, good strong running for 05 here with 25 minutes to go. Let's see if they can make some more positions up and get themselves into the top 5.
Yep, so you're on lap 22 then. And it's still Peter Enders who leads after a courageous move on Ericsson, but Ericsson's still there. 1.8 seconds, a tiny little slip up from Enders could pave the way for Ericsson to reclaim his first position. So, he's still got quite a way to go, and it's not over until that checkered flag falls.
Yeah, it looks like Enders has a slight advantage over Ericsson in the first half of the lap, and I think they're probably about equal as they go on to the oval, but it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. I think Ericsson might just have been slowing his car down a little bit and saving himself. I don't think this one's over at the front either.
They're going through the field, another battle maybe, very soon, as Talbot will come under a bit of pressure from your P7 man, who's just, well, under a second away really, and that's Phillips, again in O5 Motorsport, so could be a bit of warfare going on here. It'll be interesting to see how that one plays out, but...
Yeah, it certainly looks like George has lost a bit of time. He's had a lap time advantage over Phillips in the early part of the race, but looks like Phillips is just beginning to close in on his 05 teammate. It'll be interesting to see how this pans out, whether or not team orders will come into play, or... Well, we'll see.
Yeah, I mean, I think team orders are legal, so I wouldn't put it past them, but I don't think Talbot's going to want to give away such a high-end position right now, so... But, again, I think you're going to have to fight for it, though, it's Phillips, but we'll see how it pans out.
It looks like... Indeed, once again, we've missed some action here as Ericsson has managed to retake the lead. He just set the fastest lap of the race. Whether or not traffic played a part there, it looks like they're driving through traffic now, or whether or not Peter Enders made a mistake. Either way, Ericsson has retaken the lead. He has 22 minutes to hold on to that lead and see where he plays. See how this plays out.
Yeah, and I think there'll be a smug little smile on the face of Ericsson right now, then, as he's been trailing the back of Enders for quite some time, and now he's back up front, got some clean air as he's got through the traffic, and is trying to hopefully control that lead and take the car to a victory.
That looks like Matt Strand is now running strong, doesn't seem to be being threatened by Mohammed Patel in fourth place. And Nilsson again doesn't seem to be closing down on that triplet, so no, it doesn't look like at the moment we're going to get that battle forming. As Nick Phillips is actually getting ever closer to the back of George Talbot here. Riding on board with Nick now as they go onto the oval. Should be able to get a bit of draft off the back of George's car from this distance. It'll be interesting to see if George is going to let him pass or fight for the position. Having a quick scan through the lap times. Matt Strand has seemingly picked up pace here, and he's leaving Mohammed Patel in fourth place behind Anders Nilsson. Both Mohammed and Anders struggling in the 131s compared to the front running three cars who are now running in the 30s and 29s. Be interesting, maybe Matt Strand can catch on to the back of Peter Enders. Maybe he's going to run out of time.
Oh, spin! And as Phillips managed to save it, he's going to get, oh, he's in the wall, he's kind of running along it, and there could very well be some damage to the front left tyre, and he may need to pit up to get some pressures on, because that was absolutely disastrous there. Or, you know, it's not going to do Talbot or the team any harm, but in terms of his own core championship race, that's not the way he wanted to try and go through this, with 20 minutes left as well, and that's a crucial timescale.
Yeah, it's going to be difficult for Nick to recover that position, but it might now give Mark Foley, recovering in 8th place, a chance to get back onto terms with some of these drivers, maybe recover some of the positions which he's lost out in earlier battles.
Yeah, absolutely. So, as you say, under 20 minutes left now then, as we go on board with Robinson, that looks like he's still looking under a bit of pressure from Watson, is that still? So, he's still been constantly with one another for really like the whole race. It's like anyway, very much story. But interesting to see how that one's going to end up. No, it's Foley actually. So
yes, Foley and Robinson are running the same car, and unfortunately for us in the booth, that's is Simon just behind them. So it looks like we're looking at Nathan and Simon. Unfortunately, in actual fact, it's Mark who is recovering back through the field. Might have a chance here on Nick Phillips. Having a back look at the front of the grid, Ericsson has pulled out a 4 second gap over Enders. And Enders is falling backwards towards Matt Strand.
So well, that's great for the race. I kind of has ruined my whole love story prediction, but you know, we'll get that. Back to Enders and P2, who's trying to defend from Strand at the moment. He's quite a way back, but got himself a good 3 seconds clear of Mohamed Patel. So Nilsson's slipping away, and he's got himself in a comfort zone there. He's clear of Talbot, and he's clear of Patel as well. So he can keep there, and he could potentially drive home to a very strong result.
Indeed, Matt Strand is certainly putting in some really strong laps here. Last lap round, he was the fastest car in the field. Actually, 2 seconds a lap faster than Peter Enders. So whether or not Peter is in trouble or he's short-fueled that car, we'll find out as Matt Strand is looking to further his podium position and get up to second place.
So right now then, as a gap starts to form, it's all about consistency. If you can keep driving good laps and another driver makes a mistake, then it's happy days. But, you know, if you do make a mistake, you're going to have to work very hard to recover from it. And right now, Nilsson, I think he's just kind of, you know, taking a bit of pressure off himself. He's realised he's very clear of P6, George Talbot, and he's losing Patel as well. So as long as he can just keep at a constant sort of pace, then he could drive home to P5.
Looks like Nick Phillips still potentially going to come under pressure from Mark Foley in a couple of laps. Mark's going to have to keep it clean and consistent if he's going to want to take away that seventh place from Nick. We've got a bit of a little bit quiet on the track just now. Doesn't seem to be any real standout battles. Mike Smolcheski sitting in 11th place currently. Looks to be fighting his way back up through the field. Coming up behind Robinson, who is sitting in 10th place. For whatever reason, Mike at one point in this race had to serve an extra pit stop, whether or not that was for a penalty. We don't know, but he is catching onto the back of Robinson there. So we've just come out for 15 minutes to go. A little rundown of the top car, or the remaining car, shall we? Andreas Eriksson, he's leading the race, having had a little bit of a battle earlier with Peter Enders. He's now beginning to pull out a sizable gap, up to 5 seconds now. Peter Enders sitting in second place, was looking very racy early on, but seems to have lost a little bit of his pace. Matt Strand, Satellite Racing, is in third place now. Had a bit of a momentous start, shall we say, as it looks like. Indeed, yeah, Matt Strand's pulled into the pit lane.
So his second stop of the day, and what's this going to do then? Because maybe that's why he was so far in front, having not stopped. So this could pave the way then for Patel, who's, he's gone up into third. What about Andreas Nilsson? This is where the battle's going to commence. I think Nilsson's a bit too far behind at the moment, though.
I think Nilsson has taken it, so Strat has dropped from a solid third place down to fifth place now.
Oh, the gap's only 6.6 seconds, but could George Talbot maybe find a way into the top 5 position? That'd be a very satisfying result after some pretty emotional display earlier on featuring the contact, but you know, he could find his way back up into the field and into P5. But Foley, still P7, again, has run after dropping down the field, sort of carved his way back up the field, and it'll be nice to see what he can do.
Yeah, it looks like he's managed to take that position away from Nick Phillips at some point. Just want to see where Matt Strand fed back in there. That's probably, as we've got a car down there on the banking, just pulling over. Matt Strand has dropped into fifth place, so looks like he short-fueled his car and was maybe thinking he could run a little bit faster. He was running faster, but it looks like the other drivers may have outsmarted him here. Just trying to find out which car it is that has stopped in the infield area. It's Sergio Sousa for the Atlantic Racing team. Looks like he's just overheated that car, and that's going to have to call it a day.
Yeah, and that's not the way he wanted to end the race at all either, so very unfortunate there, but we could perhaps try and get an interview with him.
Let's see what he says. Back up the front, Ericsson is quite happily leading at this point. He's still got that 5-6 second gap over Peter Enders. Mohamed Vettel sitting in third place now with Anders Nilsson has picked up fourth place thanks to Matt Strand's rather strange strategy choice.
Yeah, I mean, it seemed like it was all going wonderfully well there for Matt Strand, but it's all sort of collapsed with 13 minutes to go. However, he's still in a strong position, and I think after being in the midst of the action for pretty much the whole race, to be still in a high position is quite rewarding. So I think what he's saying is actually play it safe instead of go all out aggression.
Yeah, he's leaving himself slightly vulnerable here to George Talbot, who is only 4 seconds behind. And if George is reaching the end of his fuel load, as we'd expect him to be, as he was one of the last to pit, he might have a significant time advantage over Matt Strand as we come into the final quarter of this race.
Let's just take a look at George Talbot then, see how he's getting on. He's a P6, so very, very slowly but surely putting the pressure on the P5. It would be great to see, especially with just over 10 minutes to go, a battle for, you know, fifth place. It's a top five position, and although, you know, it's not a podium, it's still a very creditable finish after, you know, fighting his way through down the lower end of the field. So if he has somehow pulled something out of the bag, we could see a very great battle as he goes inside of traffic, I think that is. So
yeah, but Scott Chesney, who's still recovering back, he's picked up a place off of Nathan Robinson, but he's well down the order now.
Having just talked to some of the drivers, there has been raised concerns by quite a few of the drivers about their fuel consumption, so we might see 2 to 3 drivers starting to lay off a lot of pace towards the end to save those critical last drops of fuel to make it to the end.
Down to 3.2 seconds in Strand strategy. Could go from bad to worse as Talbot starts to claw away at the lead that Strand has over him. But back at front still, Ericsson is going himself a quite comfortable 6.4 second gap over Peter Enders, and I think Enders will be quite satisfied with second position after having quite a nifty duel.
Indeed, and back to the Matt Strand, George Talbot, the unravelling race as we go, as we come into the almost into the final 10 minutes. George managed to 2 seconds a lap faster on the previous time around, so he's definitely closing down Matt. I would expect that is because Matt has had to take more fuel, and George will be coming into the end of his fuel window, so whether or not George has got enough fuel left to finish this race is open for debate. Perhaps this was a wise move by Matt to pit now. Another developing battle, as I just have a quick look there at the timings, is Anders Nilsson, who is currently sitting in fourth place, is now closing up the battle of Mohamed Patel. He's also running 2 seconds a lap faster than Patel, so perhaps Patel is struggling with fuel as he's coming into the final 10 minutes as well.
Yes, indeed. He's announced that he has gone down to boost one to try and save some fuel to make it to the end. Yes.
Oh, well, Anders Nilsson's mistake. Well, if that is the case for Mohamed, then all Anders has to do is just keep it on track and keep closing down the gap and Either way, it looks like Patel is going to have fuel issues. We're less than 10 minutes to go now.
Yeah, and it will be very, very upsetting to see a retirement just so late on in the race as well. Both Patel and Nilsson